Hey, I'm Rain.
I'm Steve.
I'm Duncan.
I'm Jason.
And we are Our Lady Peace, and you're watching Stingray Pause Play.
I'm Zach Monson, and welcome to a very special edition of Stingray Pause Play, here with Canadian super legends, Our Lady Peace. Hi, guys. How are you?
Hello.
We're good.
You know, what are those memories of being a kid where music was part of your life, whether it was a song or a concert or a family member playing an instrument that really helped solidify music as something that you wanted to do with the rest of your life?
That's an interesting question. We've been telling the story. We have a song on this new album, something that's called Ballad of a Poet, and it really talks about one of the first kind of concerts I probably saw before I really was in the music business, and it was at this thing called the Toronto Music Awards. Terrible artists, and it was really depressing, and I was literally getting up to leave, and then the last act came out of the night, and I think they won an award, but really hadn't heard of them. They're called the Tragically Hip. So it was the first time I'd seen Gord perform and heard the band play live, and it was, you know, really, when I look back on it now, in retrospect, it was a pretty profound moment in the sense of watching Gord up there. Really helped make that distinction for me in terms of what an artist was and what an entertainer was. And because I connected so profoundly with the artist side of Gord, I felt like, yeah, if I can get somewhere close to what he's doing, if that's what I can do with my life and in terms of the words I'm trying to get out there and the poetry I was writing, I felt like that would be a pretty cool thing. So it really kind of, in a way, changed my life, I think.
So, you know, that being, you know, a while ago, and Our Lady Peace being such a staple in the Canadian music scene for 20 plus years, what are those things that have changed from day one in the industry to today? What's better? What's worse?
I mean, the way we just made this record, I think, was really interesting and liberating. You know, we all came out to California. Steve and I lived there, and we went into Jackson Browne's studio, and we had a bunch of ideas. We spent 3 days there and recorded them live off the floor, which is something we've really never done as a band completely in terms of press record, listen back. Was that it? No, let's try it one more time. Okay, that's it.
Yeah, I think there were good things about big record companies and stuff when that's what was happening. But it's nice in a way for us to be able to do something like that and be like, this sounds great. This feels great. We say it's done. It's done. 20 years ago, you'd have to wait till you had a full record most of the time, put that out. But we thought, you know, it's been a long time for our fans, you know, we want to give music to them, and we can do it right now.
What's something that you guys know now that you wish you knew 20 years ago?
I don't, there's nothing that stands out. There's a shirt I wore in the back of the Clumsy record I wish I'd never put on.
Yeah. Yeah. To not hire stylists.
Well, I don't know, on this record especially, there were a lot of good little magic moments that I think we, after this long, said, no, that's great. That's a moment. It's not perfect, but it feels great. Let's go with that. Where maybe 10 years ago, 15 years ago, we would have like thought more about it.
Once you can stay together long enough, you stop listening to any voices at all, and you get back to that naive place where it's really about, does this song make me feel something?
Right.
And so we've been able to kind of come full circle now, and I think that's the thing I'm most proud of with this band.
We asked the last artist that we had in to ask you guys a question.
Hattie, I'm Zach from Portugal the Man, and I wanted to ask you a question. What is the most embarrassing thing that has either happened to you or somebody else on stage ever? I fall a lot. I'd like to know.
Most embarrassing thing. Well, there was this festival. I don't know if you guys remember this. We were playing with STP. And I had a pair of pants on, and this is before.
Is that not something you usually did? You didn't wear pants usually?
I usually wear pants, but this is before like stretch denim.
Yeah.
And they're a little tight maybe, and they literally split from my crotch all the way down to my leg.
Oh my God.
Yeah, and I had to go somehow.
Didn't Kevin take
I had
you
to
up?
Like get our tour manager to meet me at the side stage and like gaff tape them up, but. There's about 3 or 4 minutes where I was trying to finish the song that I stood like a soldier with my legs together and, you know, junk was hanging out in him.
You know, after 8 albums, I know we touched on it a little bit, but was there a a most memorable moment creating this whole album from start to finish, whether it was the conception of a song or a recording moment or somebody coming by to say hi you didn't expect?
To me, it is those couple of moments I can remember. I know we keep talking about Ballad of a Poet, but
when
we went to East West Studios and we got to be in the same studio, the same room where the Chili Peppers and System of a Down and the Beverly Hillbillies theme was recorded, all these classic things. And the room, you can hear it too. It just sounds great. And we were trying to do things live and hearing that back after, like, you know, getting sounds and everything. I think we listened to it 3 or 4 times. It was just like, play it again. Play it again.
It's amazing when, you know, we always get that from other people's music and you're inspired through that device of listening to other music. But when it's actually your own music and you're sitting there going, wow, is this really us? That feeling, I think, like as an artist, you're always trying to attain that. And we definitely got very close on this record.
Where you sit down and literally listen back to back.
Yeah, and you look at each other.
It's 3 a.m.
Yeah, and you're looking at each other going, this is amazing. Like, I hope other people get to hear this.
It's a great song. I mean, the album is beautiful. That song is really something special. You can hear that you're not just writing a tribute to Gord. It's not that kind of a song. It's about so much more. It's about that feeling and that, exactly, we keep saying that moment, you know, but,
right.
And it really comes through. Where on the scale of fears for you guys does relevancy sit? Are you worried about trying to be a relevant band? Are you worried about being a band of the 90s? Because, I mean, the album does not sound like a different band. You still sound like Our Lady Peace. You just sound like Our Lady Peace in 2017. But is it a worry about writing music, how your fans will react if you don't sound a certain way or write a certain way or perform a certain way?
There's so many demos of songs that sound like Our Lady Peace that I think our fans would probably be like, great, but it doesn't do a lot for us. So... Yeah. The balance is being true to ourselves, because we're not going to go get Kendrick to come and guest on an OLP song just so we can get on hip hop radio.
I got to tell you, beyond getting on hip hop radio, that might just be a really good song.
I love Kendrick as well. I think in this record we found a really great balance with a friend of ours, Jason Leiter, who helped co-produce the record and is pretty integral in terms of, you know, just being like the hip guy in the room. You know, his sound design and some of the electronic stuff we add in, but it never outdoes what we are just as a unit. I think we found a pretty good balance this time.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, speaking of balance, touring with Matt Good, which is just like the greatest combination of bands I can think of to play, how do you guys both balance your sets with the new and the old? Is it more new than more old? I mean, how do you guys balance what the audience might want to hear versus what you want to play?
It's a nice problem to have. I say that much. When you go, you look at the set, you're like, well, we only have an hour, you know, we only have 75 minutes. Well, got to get this song and this song. Yeah, but I want to do this song and this song. It almost becomes like an arm wrestling match sometimes. But, you know, it's a nice problem to have.
I think what's amazing for the fans is the fact that it's a different set every night. We literally have just a catalog of songs that we've rehearsed and are going to play, but switch it up every night. So, you know, and I think we all understand there's fans that'll travel and come to a bunch of shows. Yeah. So, it's not like they're seeing the same show every night. And for us as artists, you love the fact that, you know, we're able to play different things on different evenings.
Having such a deep catalog, do you find it hard to remember all your... Like, I can't remember my name most of the time, let alone 8 albums of songs. Is that an issue for you?
I don't think I've ever messed up one lyric.
I'm going to go ahead and say that's probably not true, Rand.
Yeah, man, my brain is full.
And, there are no teleprompters yet.
When those moments come where you're thinking like, yeah, I don't know the next verse, do you say nothing? Do you mumble or do you make it up?
I don't know if I've ever said I don't know the next verse. I've definitely missed a line here and there. But I mean, you know, these things are like, they're like our children. So there's a certain integrity and, you know, we do rehearse and I go over lyrics. And it's a funny thing. There's like a psychological thing where I do have a full disclosure, a book of lyrics in front of me. As long as that's there, I don't forget one.
Right.
As soon as it's not there, yeah, I'm a mess. Yeah. And I'm weeping and I just fall to the floor on stage.
Sounds like a good show.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tearing pants, falling to the stage crying. You put on a good show.
Yeah.
You really do. Everyone's been so excited about this tour and, you know, everyone's so excited about Matt Good. What's something about Matt Good that his fans might not know but that they would love?
We have to be respectful.
No, you don't. In any way. he wouldn't be respectful of you.
I love he kind of pops in at random moments, which is great. Let's be hanging out in the dressing
room.
He's
a bit of a close talker.
I can see that, actually. Yeah, I can see that. His vibe is close talking.
You know, a lot of guys will be tend to be more reserved or whatever. Sometimes you turn around and Matt's like, he's just there right in the room and he's got something to tell you. And
we both have asthma. And so the other night he just came in right before he was like, "Here, man, it's with
take
his inhaler."
Ventolin,
I'm like, I'm okay. I'm good right now. He's like, "No, take it."
He was feeling a little breathy, so he wanted to make sure.
Right,
you
were yeah, good. Yeah. It was there's a
it's
lot
like when
of
your grandmother
there.
Says, "I'm cold. You should put on a sweater." Right, it's right, that yeah. same exact yeah. thing. Yeah. Guys, thank you so much for chatting with me. I love the new album. I'm excited for album 9, 10, 11. I'm sure that they'll be there. I can't wait for the show tonight. You can hear Somethingness from Our Lady Peace on Adult Alternative, Rock Alternative, and the Rock Channel. And of course, the other 7 albums on Alt Rock Classics, Greatest Hits, Top Detente, Maximum Party, Nothing But 90s. And of course, all of our Stinger Music's Vibes channels available now on our mobile app and our web player. Don't forget to give us a thumbs up, a like, leave us a comment, and of course, subscribe to keep up with all the newest episodes of Stingray Pause Play. See you next time.